All right, so I think we'll go ahead and get started. We wanted to say welcome to Cornell, Cal's and New York State IPM and the Department of Ag and Markets Integrated Pest Management Educational Forum. Really pleased that everybody could be here today. Just before we get started, I wanted to go over a few quick housekeeping issues. My name is Julie Suarez. I'm Associate Dean of the College of Ag and Life Sciences for Land Grant Affairs. Should have introduced myself first, sorry. And I would like to make sure that you know that we'll be taking questions at the end. So for everybody who's here, we welcome your questions. If you don't mind popping them into either the chat box or the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen, we'd be more than happy to address any questions that you may have at the end of the presentations. So with that, I'm going to share my screen and we will go ahead and get started. Again, welcome to Cornell Cal's and New York State Department of Ag and Markets and our New York State IPM Forum's Educational Forum on Integrated Pest Management. Really pleased today that Commissioner Richard Ball is able to kick us off on this educational forum. The commissioner is somebody who is not only an excellent, fabulous commissioner for your New York State Department of Ag and Markets and the governor, he's also somebody who's been a longtime farmer. And farming is near and dear to his heart, and he is a longtime practitioner of integrated pest management on his farm located in the fabulous Schoharie Valley of New York State. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Commissioner Ball and have him kick our forum off. Thank you, Commissioner.
Well, thank you, Julie. Appreciate the very kind words and introduction. This is an easy one for me to want to do because I've made my living in agriculture since I was 18 years old and early on learned these three letters, integrated pest management, IPM. As a management system for us to do a better job at what we do in farming. And I was so amazed and always been a little bit curious about it. I remember going to a meeting early on and someone said, it was a Cornell extension person, and had a group of growers together and said, what does IPM mean to you? And a lot of people went around the room and voiced their opinions, and they got to me and I said, it means common sense. That's what it means. It means common sense. It means looking at what the challenges that we have in our crop. It means knowing the enemy, whether it's a weed or an insect or a disease, and then educating ourselves on all the tools that are available and the best way to manage that. I could tell you countless stories about some of the management issues we've had growing crops over the years, whether it was a disease or an insect, and how we learned how to grow and figure out that critter and use the tools available, and as a result, get better crops with less impact on the environment, less impact on our workers, and less impact on our food. IPM is the way we will continue to grow in New York State. We have an excellent program at Cornell. We have a brand new IPM director you're going to meet shortly, Alejandro, Calixto. And we're at an important place and time in New York State. We live in a time of great science. We live in a time of great technology. And we live in a time when the world has growing needs for our food and our growers to do a better job. I think we can answer those problems right here with IPM. So thanks so much for the opportunity. Appreciate it.
Commissioner, thank you. As always, I'm always inspired by your remarks and your thoughtful discussions, and you're absolutely right. IPM is just about common sense. What makes the most sense to alleviate risk and to grow really excellent food right here in New York in our wonderful soils that we have in New York. So again, Commissioner, I thank you. I appreciate your leadership. I'm going to go ahead and introduce the rest of our panelists today, and then we're going to go ahead through our presentations. So first up, the commissioner is right. We're really lucky to have the skills and expertise of Dr. Alejandro Calixto, who is our brand new New York State Integrated Pest Management Director. He heads up both our agricultural and our community IPM side. We were very fortunate to bring Alejandro from with his background in both industry in Florida and academia in Texas. And I like to think of Alejandro as a climate refugee. He decided that he wanted to study different pests and disease pressures that we have in the Northeast. So welcome, Alejandro, and he'll be our first speaker for the day. What I will do, however, is I'm going to introduce all the other speakers and we'll just kind of seamlessly flow through the presentation. Next up, we have Dan Olmstead. Dan is our technical computer guru. He is what I refer to as our digital ag specialist in IPM and effectively oversees our NEWA network, which you'll learn a little bit more about. We also have Dr. Jody Gangloff-Kaufmann, who deals with all sorts of fun pests on the community side, from rats, bed bugs, ticks, and everything else you can think of that gives people the heebie-jeebies. So welcome to Jody. We also have Dr. David Gadoury, who is headquartered at Cornell AgriTech in Geneva. David is a longtime senior research associate on our faculty, and he's going to talk about some recent breakthroughs utilizing UV light to control disease. And of course, last but not least, we have the fabulous Dr. Juliet Carroll. She's our fruit IPM specialist, and she's also a senior extension associate. And her job is one of my favorites. She gets to go around and talk to growers and help them grow fruit profitably, economically, and in an environmentally sustainable manner. So with that, I'm going to turn it right over to Alejandro. And thank you so much, Alejandro.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Juliet. Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you, Commissioner Ball, for that beautiful introduction. And Julie, you being the engine putting these forums together. And on behalf of the College of Agriculture, Cornell AgriTech, and the New Jersey IPM program, we would like to welcome you to our first virtual IPM forum. We're hoping this is the first of many of these activities in the future. So next one, please, Julie. So this is the outline of my presentation today. So I really want to spend a couple of minutes just making a brief introduction about our program. And then I'm just going to talk about the history of IPM. I just want to provide some background that I'm going to use to later define what is and what is not IPM. Then I'll just discuss very briefly some of the challenges and opportunities that we have. And then I'm just going to leave that presentation with two take-home messages. Next. So we're a relatively new program. We have 35 years of experience working in the state. Our program was established in 1985 through legislation added to the Ag and Markets Law. And it pretty much reinforced the Cornell IPM program. Our funding comes via the New York State Department of Agriculture and Markets and the Department of Environmental Conservation. And we have Commissioner Ball today. And of course, we want to thank you for the continuing support to our program. Next one. So our mission, the mission of the IPM program is to develop sustainable tools. And you are going to see some of the tools that we are developing currently. And the idea is to manage pests and help people to use these methods to help minimizing the risk in the environment, human health, and the economy. So we're a group of 17 specialists that we have pretty much statewide responsibilities, and we cover multiple commodities. We have vegetables, we have fruits, field crops, and livestock. Ornamentals, but we also have a strong component in community IPM. Next one. So I always, every time I talk about IPM, I always want to talk very briefly, and I'm gonna try to be very ambitious today just to go through the history of IPM in 60 seconds. And pretty much what I wanna provide the public is with some information to understand how we got here. So the concept of pest management has been around the human civilization for thousands of years. So we can go back in history, 2,500 years BC, and there's some records of humans, Sumerians more specifically, using sulfur compounds to manage a pest. And then we see an evolution, more development by humans to manage the pests in their crops. And there's some really beautiful examples. One of the ones that I like the most, one of my favorite ones, is the Chinese using ants in citrus groves to manage some of the key pests. And that's a really interesting concept. It's the first time that you can find a reference of humans using an organism as a biological control agent, but also a way how they were increasing the complexity in the crop to enhance the activity of those organisms. They were using ants and they were using bamboo sticks connecting the citrus trees so the ants could move from one tree to another, increasing that complexity and resilience in the system. And then there's a lot of records about using more compounds derived from plants and et cetera, et cetera. And there's a period that I have some different colors during the Second War that I'm just gonna go back in a second. That's when we see what we call the Green Revolution, more people growing more food and being more efficient. And then we go on the last 3-4 decades, there's a huge amount of investment and development on innovation, particularly on the crop protection area. We see an increased development on host plant resistant induced and also on selecting varieties that are resistant to some pests. We see a lot of work towards the increase of adoption of biological control agents. And then pretty much where we are right now, the digital era. So we've never been as connected as today. And people are using digital technologies to better predict and manage the pests in their crops. And also this idea of building ecological resistance, kind of going back to the basics, what the Chinese were doing, just providing the system some tools to become more resilient so you can reduce the risk that are caused by the pests. Next one, Julie. So, and I really want to focus on this period after the Second War until the early 1970s, because this period really defined IPM. And what happens is that during the Second War, there was a chemical that everyone knows, probably knows, is called DDT. It was an old chemistry. It was discovered by a German student in the late 1800s. And it was used during the Second War. It had some insecticidal activity on insects. And it was widely used to control body lice. So for those that they don't remember body lice was the vector of typhus. It is a bacteria that is closely related to Lyme disease, and it was widely used on soldiers, and it did a pretty good job. It saved the lives of many soldiers during that period. And after the Second War, we see what I mentioned earlier, this Green Revolution, more development in tools for crop protection, better use of water, adoption of different irrigation systems, but also an increased use of pesticides. There was an increased use of development and registration of pesticides. And growers, for the first time, were able to produce and increase their yields and make money because they were adopting better agronomic practices. Unfortunately, with that, there were some issues that were presented. And in the early 60s, Rachel Carson, on a series of essays, she started pretty much exposing the issues in terms of pollution, but also the issues related to the misuse and overuse of some pesticides. So she published all those essays in her book, The Silent Spring, in 1962. And after that, we see this environmental movement, which led us into the 70s. And in the 70s, after President Richard Nixon was elected as the president, he issued an executive order, and the idea was to create an agency to oversee and regulate the use of these pesticides. So that agency is the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency. A year after EPA was created, it was late 1970. After a year of EPA was created, DDT was canceled. But also the government instructed the Department of Agriculture to create nationwide IPM programs. And that's probably the first time that we move from pest management and we start hearing more about integrated pest management, developing tools to manage more effectively and safe pests. Next. So with all that background information, I think I'm ready to define what is IPM. So IPM is a sustainable science-based decision-making process that integrates, and that's the key word, integrates biological, cultural, physical, and chemical tools to reduce the risk associated to pests. And I have these triangle here. There's different ways how do you approach a pest, but you always have to think the first thing that you have to do to manage, and you have to think down in the future, is prevention. So you have to be ahead of time with your pests. And there's different ways how you can prevent the pests to have a negative impact in you or your crop. So a cultural practices, using host plants resistant, you selecting those varieties that are resistant to insects and diseases. Also augmenting, increasing the number of biological control agents in the system. Once things start getting a little bit out of control, then you have to be more proactive. And it's an adaptive management system. You have to follow some steps. And if you are moving away from prevention, you start going into intervention. And of course, as you get more and more into intervention, is when you might end up using some chemical to have some effective management. And you have to understand that once you start getting to that point, the toxicity, also the risk of toxicity also increases. Next one. So, and what is not IPM? And IPM, I just want to make this very clear, because every time I talk to people, some people, and I'm not saying everyone, there's always a confusion about that IPM is only managing a pest using a pesticide. And that's why IPM is often linked to pesticides, mainly because of the history that I try to share with you today. But it's not only about using pesticides, it's an integrated approach. Pesticides should be used in IPM programs when no effective alternatives are available, or the alternatives, all those tools that you have, are not sufficient to keep those pests under control. And there's some very unique situations. You know, we're dealing every day with invasive species, for instance, and sometimes you have to be very aggressive. Of course, remember, you have to stay in that prevention mode, but if you have invasives moving into your systems, most likely you're gonna have to be very aggressive and rely on some type of pesticide. Next one. Another thing that I like to define here to the group is what is a pest. So, and because of the history, remember DDT and body lice, pests are always management. IPM, integrated pest management, is also linked to only insects, but a pest can be an insect, it can be a plant, a weed that you have in your yard, it can be a disease that is showing up in your plant. So remember, keep that in mind. It can be an organism that has a negative effect on humans, human value resources, and of course the environment. Next one. So some of the challenges and opportunities, and these are three of the probably the most important ones, climate change, and that's not news to you. So a very small increase in temperature, 1 degree, for us doesn't mean a lot, but it means a lot for an insect. You are providing the conditions for a pest to grow faster in that system, to stay longer in the system, and also to provide conditions to overwinter and reinforce those fields rapidly. So climate change is really a game changer for IPM, and we're trying to learn more about this problem. Invasive species, and I have this background picture, is the spotted lantern fly. It was recently introduced in New York State. We have it just near Ithaca, was found last week. So invasive species, they're rapidly being introduced into our environments and into our community. So we have to be more proactive, preventing invasive species to get in our country and in our state. And lastly, the lack of adoption of IPM. And I have to say that to some extent, particularly the ag community has been done a pretty good job adopting IPM. We still have some gaps that we have to fill. And also on the community side, we have to educate more the people in urban communities about what is IPM and what is important to adopt IPM in our lives. Next one. Some of the opportunities, so sustainable agriculture. And I want to mention this one because, again, we're living in a world that we're connected. Everybody has access to information. And now people, they want to know how the crops are being grown. What do you use to protect that crop? But also, what are you doing to protect the people that are working in those fields? And also, what are you doing to protect and reduce the impact in the environment? So we have tremendous opportunities in our state. The organic production is growing more and more. So we're looking at more sustainable ways to grow of food and that are reducing the risk to the environment and the people. The integration of biopesticides. I used to work for a chemical company, and it's amazing the amount of R&D that is going into building the new generation of pesticides. Pesticides that have better environmental profile. They're softer on humans and the environment, and they are more compatible with IPM practices. So we're gonna see a tremendous change within the next 5 and 10 years. And we are working, trying to understand better these tools in our program and in the state. And lastly, the digital tools for IPM. Again, I mean, we're just using cell phones. We're looking satellite imagery, drones. We're better equipped to predict a pest. And you're gonna hear from one of our specialists about one of our flagship programs, the NEWA program. And pretty much that predictive and precision agriculture is really the way we have to better manage and predict pests. Next one. So these are the two take-home messages from my presentation. The first one is, remember, IPM is a process that integrates biological, cultural, physical, and chemical tools to reduce the risk. And second, you have to focus on prevention in your house, in your crop. If you are ahead of the pest, you are gonna be a better job protecting yourself and your value resources from nuisance pests. And that's all I have today. Thank you so much for joining us. And just a quick reminder, we have a lot of information in our website, the New York State IPM program. We have presence in Twitter, Facebook, YouTube channel, Instagram, and Flickr. So thank you so much for joining us today. Have a great weekend.
Thank you, Alejandro. Now we welcome Dan.
Yep, quick sound check.
Yep, you're perfect. Okay.
Great, thanks so much. So I'm gonna talk about the Network for Environment and Weather Applications, or NEWA for short. So you'll hear a lot of people refer to it that way. If you go to newa.cornell.edu, you're gonna find a collection of online digital tools and resources. And we have over 40 at this point. They use live weather data, which I'll talk about in a moment, to really encourage the implementation of best practices in IPM for a whole variety of commodities and products. Before I go further though, if you look at the right-hand side, I just wanna provide a visual of what we're trying to prevent when we're talking about NEWA and the resources we have. So the top image is apple maggot. So without adequate mitigation or prevention of this insect pest, in apple crops, if I go to the store and I take a great big bite out of this apple, I'm not going to be too apple. It's not going to appeal to me to want to eat that apple again or go back there. The one below that, interestingly, also relates to apples, and this is a bacterial disease of trees called fire blight. And so if you don't promptly treat this, you can incur very significant economic damage. In some cases, you could lose an entire orchard in a very short period of time. And then finally, in vegetables, another, as it happens, fly pest, onion maggot, can have pretty serious impacts. But keep that in mind as I talk. On the left-hand side, I've got a complete listing in this table of all of the resources and tools we have across all of our commodities. And I'm not going to go into detail, but I'm just including this to show you the breadth and depth of what we offer digitally statewide. The last thing I'll mention on this slide is that NEWA is a partnership in the truest sense of the word. So New York State Integrated Pest Management Program collaborates closely with the Northeast Regional Climate Center in the Department of Earth and Atmospheric Sciences. They are affiliated with the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and they receive federal funding to work with folks like us on agricultural outreach. In fact, they really specialize in that area out of all the climate centers in the country. But then there's also Cornell Cooperative Extension. So we have our faculty and staff here in the IPM program, but we also work with folks on our regional team. So field crops, livestock, fruit, vegetables, statewide, and you'll see that impact in a slide or two here. Next slide. So to give you a sense geographically of what NEWA does and where it has a presence, this is a statewide map, and each blue dot is a live physical weather station that is feeding data to newa.cornell.edu right now. So in total, we have 167 of these locations. And interestingly, you'll see that there are clusters. This relates or correlates to our most important commodity areas right now, or I should say most used. They're all equally important. But apple and grape production have really driven NEWA's sustainability and growth pretty much since its inception. And so these areas, Hudson Valley, Western New York, Finger Lakes, and Northern New York, get the most use. In terms of the equipment itself, I won't go into detail too much, but there's a couple of different ways a person can be involved. First, you don't have to have a weather station. You can go to any of our locations and use it free of charge. It's open access. But if I'm a grower or an operation, I can use my own private funds to work with one of two weather station vendors who we partner with, OnSet or Rainwise, and get on-site weather data. It makes our information even more precise. Lastly, again, NRCC plugs in a bunch of NOAA-based weather stations to create the network that you see here. Next slide. So we're talking a lot about the technology, but technology by itself only takes you so far. I mentioned, you know, we've got experts here on faculty and staff at the IPM program and Cornell Cooperative Extension, but we also work closely across the College of Agriculture and Life Sciences with our research colleagues. Everything you see on NEWA is research-based. And so ideally, peer-reviewed research has demonstrated that a certain model has benefit. But the idea is to combine our human capital with our web technologies and resources to push these IPM best practices out to our entire population across the state, across commodities, in order to extend our reach and impact. So we can only do so much person to person. Only so many people come to our workshops or field meetings or twilight meetings and so on and so forth. NEWA is a way that we have been able to overcome that barrier and achieve our impact. Very quickly on the right-hand side is a website that we are releasing in 2021. And I'm sharing it here because we really value our end users. So our growers, our extension colleagues, our folks in IPM who have that multiplier effect. And so this whole website is built based on the premise of what do the end users really need. And I'll just add that this was a USDA funded initiative and there's really a lot of backing behind it even beyond Cornell. So next slide, please. So it's one thing to have a nice looking website, be able to say, yeah, we've got great models, but it has to translate into impact, like I was saying before. How do we know that people are using this, that they find value in it? And so the last two slides here I'm going to touch on. Again, we have a statewide map. This is a heat map based on the number of unique page views per county from January 1 up until I think November 20th. So you can see that across the board, we've got really good coverage. These darker areas, again, correspond with those higher use areas of apple and grape production. But even these light green shaded counties are showing us that people are becoming more interested in our vegetable tools. People are becoming more interested in using it as a field crops resource. And so statewide, we're getting really good use patterns with this. On the right-hand side, this shows over the past few years, a steady upward trend in the number of users who are accessing our site. We've got a really good base of returning users, but we, interestingly, in the past couple of years, we also have a lot of new folks who are coming for the first time to figure out what NEWA is and what it can do for them. Next slide. All right, and so really the take-home message is that people are using NEWA. They are accessing NYSIPM resources, which intertwine with what Extension does and across the college. In 2017, Juliet, Carroll, and myself, you'll be hearing from her in a few minutes, did a survey across all of our NEWA users, and we had really good response. These are the results of that survey. And so we can quantify the economic impact and the environmental impact of what NEWA is doing. So when we ask growers about tangible value, 95% say spray timings are improved if they do in fact need to make them. 92% say it enhances their overall approach to IPM practices. 86% say that they are actually alerted early to pest risks and it gives them time to mitigate the situation. And finally, 79% say it directly reduces the number of pesticide sprays that they have to spray. Again, as Alejandro said, it's not that we never use pesticides, but if we have to use them, let's use them effectively. And that is one of the goals of NEWA. If we look at the economic side, just to close out my portion of this presentation, when we look at the average annual savings reported by that same group of NEWA users, $2,000 on average in overall per acre savings, $4,000 in reduced spray costs, and then across in an operation on average, this is really the take-home message, $33,000 in avoided crop losses. So I'm able to recover a greater proportion of what I'm growing as opposed to if I weren't able to treat it effectively. And with that, I'll turn it back over to you, Julie. Thank you.
Great, Juliet, do you want to pop in?
Yes, I was muted. Sorry about that.
No worries.
Okay, so I'm going to tell you a story about a tiny invasive fruit fly, spotted wing. Next slide. So this insect was introduced in 2011, and we did some research on its potential threat to New York's cherry crops at that time, and we estimated the loss might reach maybe 2%. We weren't very concerned. Fast forward to 2017, and much of the processing tart cherry crop was dumped on the ground because it was contaminated with larvae of this insect. So reevaluating those estimated losses, I'm projecting now that the cherry crops in New York could suffer, if unprotected, upwards of 80% loss from infestation by this insect. That translates into a $3.5 million production value loss. So in the corner there, you can see the cherry with those little sort of papery things and the blemishes all over it. Spotted wing, when it comes out of the fruit and pupates, it leaves its little pupal case there on the cherry, unlike with other fruit that it infests. Not very appetizing at all. And the little larvae, they're only like 1 to 3 millimeters long, so they're very difficult to detect. So what's the big deal? Well, invasive species disrupt IPM because to combat them, sprays are applied every 5 to 7 days. But IPM monitoring for spotted wing can inform when to spray to protect the fruit. Next slide, Julie. This is what the tart cherry crop looked like in 2017. Dumped on the ground because it was rejected at the processor because it had those little tiny white maggots in it. Our Lake Ontario cherry industry was devastated by spotted wing. In Lake Ontario's microclimate, cherry harvests are later than in orchards inland, and spotted wing arrives earlier near the lake. Well, could an IPM approach protect New York's tart cherries, even in the Lake Ontario region, from this fruit fly? Spoiler alert, the answer is yes. Next slide, Julie. So the IPM approach is spotted wing monitoring. We wanted to find out, is the Lake Ontario microclimate placing cherries at higher risk? And can fruit fly monitoring provide enough information to protect the cherry crop? IPM monitoring informs the grower when they need to spray, so they can tailor their spray program and reduce unnecessary sprays. Next slide, Julie. So here's the monitoring results in 2018. The super exciting aspect is that few to no spotted wing sprays were needed in inland orchards, underlining the importance of IPM monitoring. So if you look at the numbers circled in black, the first spotted wing catch was in July, and only very few were caught. But by the time they were caught, either the crop was already harvested or it was only 2 weeks from harvest. Compare that to the area in blue, where the earliest trap catch in the lakeside orchards was way, way earlier than inland. And in brown, near the lake, the first catch was 3 to 8 weeks ahead of harvest. Ouch. But the IPM program based on trapping protected the crop from infestation as shown in the last two columns on the right where there's no infestation. Now that's fine. So in 2019, again, the exciting thing, few to no spotted wing sprays needed in inland orchards, underlining the importance of IPM monitoring instead of just spraying because the fruit is ripening. Trap catch near Lake Ontario was, wow, 6 weeks earlier than inland. And spotted wing was caught 8 to 10 weeks ahead of cherry harvest. Severe pressure, 250 flies caught per week, caused the insecticide program to fail in one orchard. And we were actually able to trace that back to a choice of insecticides that the grower had used and its efficacy against spotted wing. Next slide. So in conclusion, in the Lake Ontario microclimate, we found spotted wing does arrive earlier and it builds up sooner. We know that this microclimate delays cherry harvest in those regions, and this combination places cherries at extreme risk of spotted wing infestation. But spotted wing IPM informs the timing of sprays, and New York cherry growers can protect their fruit. Yes. Next slide. So what's next? We're going to educate cherry growers across New York about spotted wing monitoring and associated spray choices. We're also going to explore an easier trapping method so growers can use it on their farms. They won't have to rely on a trap network that's sparsely distributed across the state. They'll use fewer insecticide sprays. They'll save money and the environment. They'll protect their health and their workforce. And hey, they may even plant more cherry orchards. So instead of like it looking like the orchard at the top where the cherries have been cut down and pushed out, it'll look like the cherry orchard on the bottom with the brand new trees planted. Next slide. Thank you for your attention this afternoon. If you want more info about this pesky fruit fly and the crops it attacks, I'd suggest you go to the easy website, fruit.cornell.edu/spottedwing, or sign up for my blog. just Google Spotted Wing Blog Cornell. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Juliet. That was fabulous. Now we're going to welcome Jody.
Okay, so I'm going to tell you about some efforts that have happened with urban rodents, and I'm focusing mainly on rats and the work of Dr. Matt Fry. So next slide. So we probably all know that all cities, all suburbs, rural towns, farms have Norway rats and house mice. And focusing on rats, they can do a ton of damage. Here you see a picture of a New York City park, and the holes are rodent, rat burrows in that park, and there's a number of them. But what the impact is that the park is ugly and the vegetation is destroyed. In addition to all the different things that rats can do, they really are an aesthetic and visible pest. Next slide. But what's important to us is the human exposure to pathogens. Now, rats can expose humans to pathogens in several ways, or two ways. Direct transmission is when a human comes into contact with a rat or its debris, its urine and feces, the pretty stuff. Or exposure can happen through a vector, and that is when an ectoparasite, a flea, a tick, a mite on that animal vectors a disease to humans. And so vectors tend to be arthropods that live on the outside of the rodent host in the fur. Next slide. So using IPM for rodents is important. It's not only important, it is fundamental because there is no silver bullet for rodent management. And emerging infectious diseases of humans originate in animal reservoirs. We are currently dealing with a pandemic that originated in animal reservoirs. So I can't stress enough how important rodent management and rodent research is. Now, IPM can reduce the use of rodenticides, which is also a goal, while improving the success of rodent management, again, a goal. And we are, our program promotes a build them out approach to rodent management, which is also known as pest exclusion. We're hoping to attain widespread adoption of pest exclusion as a major tool, as the first tool in the pest management industry nationwide. And all of this would lead to better pest management that will protect human health. Next slide. Now, one of the first projects that Dr. Fry did when he arrived at our program is the participation in this research where 133 wild Norway rats were collected in New York City, and they were analyzed in their tissues and their fur and everything for disease organisms, pathogens, and also for the ectoparasites, the fleas and ticks and mites that might be in their fur. And it resulted in these two different papers, two different focuses, and I'll talk about them. Next slide. So the pathogens collected from New York City rats were various, and some were known and some were new. And that's an important development. There's a great diversity of microbes that are carried by rats and by mice too. And there's a real need for an improvement in the pathogen surveillance and monitoring in urban environments. We have novel and known viruses. We have typical things you'd expect like E. coli and Salmonella. And there are also fever-inducing organisms like Bartonella and a hantavirus that was not expected. Next slide. Now on the other side, Dr. Fry's work included parasite sampling. I show this picture because this is a collected and deceased rodent, but the fleas are coming right off this rodent. You can see the number of them. Next slide. So the disease vector analysis here included the discovery of oriental rat flea and spined rat louse. Now, if you know your history, the oriental rat flea is responsible for the Black Death, the bubonic plague in Europe long ago. And that was caused by Yersinia pestis, a bacteria that was looked for in the study, not detected, thank God, in New York City. But and the spined rat louse can transmit typhus. So there is a real need to fully characterize the diversity and the types of ectoparasites on Norway rats, on mice, and to assess their role in vector-borne disease transmission, considering that, a vector-borne disease is, an animal origin disease is affecting us in this great way today. Next slide. So another project that was done recently is started to ask the question, can we improve rodent control around food plants? Now, food plants absolutely need rodent control programs by federal law, And at the bottom, you see a box that can either contain baits or it can contain traps. And usually the baits are used outside, the traps inside. Can we improve this? So next slide. More specifically, do environmental conditions around those traps and baits boxes affect how often rats will visit those control devices? Now the data was collected on rat activity from both bait and trap boxes in 12 locations, including New York and Toronto. There was a site inspection, characteristics of each box location were recorded, and inside there were 76 types of characteristics around that box, and outside there were 27 different characteristics. The data collected was the amount of bait consumed on the outside of the building and the amount of rodent trap catches on the inside. Next slide. Environmental conditions we looked at included whether or not there's shelter on the outside vegetation. On the inside, you see this pile of debris. The box location. Did it matter if the box was on the outside of the building, on the warm side, the sunny side, or the cloudy, you know, dark side of the building? That influences temperature. Was there food and water? Were there pathways to food and water? Was there disturbance, a mower that came by or a walkway? And was there access to the building? So this box on the bottom is close to an access point that allows entry into the building. So next slide. So the results of this research was yes, environmental conditions do influence rat movements and their interaction with these devices. So trap catches and the bait feeding both increased with higher temperatures and proximity to food and lower disturbance, access to buildings, and also shelter. So the conclusion from this research is important. The normal recommendations for placement of these types of devices is every 30 to 50 feet, and that is not optimal. We can improve the use of baits and actually reduce the use of rodenticide while also improving the use of traps by placing them in areas we know we've predicted that rodents will be active. And so that's an important conclusion for practical pest management, rodent management. Next slide. So another effort that Dr. Fry and I were involved with is the Scientific Coalition on Pest Exclusion, which is a nationwide working group of people from California, Massachusetts, Minnesota, Louisiana, New York. And it's an outreach effort to the pest control industry to promote the idea of excluding pests, keeping them out. You can see here, we're inspecting some doors in the New York City Housing Authority buildings, and there's a significant gap under which a mouse could easily get. We've put a lot of the conclusions and resources for use at pestexclusion.org, and we still continue today to promote this. Next slide. So the bottom line is more needs to be done to understand rodent disease potential and to improve rodent management, considering that emerging diseases are really a critical issue today. And next slide. If you want to see more about rats in the time of coronavirus, that blog at the bottom is a really good article. And thank you to the USDA and DEC and Dr. Fry, Dr. Corrigan, Dr. Kells. Thanks.
Jody, thank you. I admit that all I can think about right now is that article that made the rounds. I think it was last week, of that poor man in New York City who fell into the sinkhole and got his own bird's eye view of the problem of urban rats. So next up, David.
Well, that's a tough act to follow, but I'll try. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm David Gadoury. I'm the project director for a team of scientists that works in the general area of light and plant health. So I'm going to start with a very high altitude view of the science. Microbial pathogens have been attacking plants for millions of years amidst endlessly repeated cycles of light and darkness. Now, in that time, they evolved to sense, to interpret, and they use light to direct their development. To show you how that works, I'm going to talk about how we use just one evolutionary trait against one pathogen group. And that trait and pathogen group is how powdery mildews deal with ultraviolet light. And I'm going to do that in 5 minutes. So don't blink, you're going to miss something important. Next slide, please. So why do you even bother with powdery mildews? Well, because they attack just about everything we grow. Now, fungicides and disease-resistant varieties are very important in IPM programs, but fungicide resistance and breakdowns in the plant's resistance mean that we need alternatives for IPM programs and for sustainable production. That's especially true in organic production systems. And to make matters even more challenging, New York's climate favors severe powdery mildew epidemics. Next, please. So let's go back in time a little bit to the early 1990s. This is a fitting example of just how far we've come in this research area. So here we have a tractor-drawn array of UVC germicidal lamps that we used in 1991 to suppress powdery mildew on grapevines. Now, powdery mildew is the greatest disease threat to the $6.6 billion New York grape and wine industry. In 1991, our UVC treatments were really effective in controlling powdery mildew. They also defoliated the vines, and it also made the grapes look a little bit like small potatoes. So to put it mildly, that wasn't the success we were anticipating. Next slide, please. Now, George Eastman, who founded the Eastman Kodak Company, said if you can understand a process, you can control the alternatives. And that's exactly what happened next in the project. So next slide, please. Because a few years ago, a PhD student on the research team made a breakthrough discovery that nighttime applications of UV were much more effective than daytime applications. And that discovery lowered the required UV dose to about 10% of what we were using before during daylight. Next slide, please. Now, I could tell you all about this, and you could read about the biochemical and genetic aspects of this phenomenon in excruciating detail. For the bottom line, for practical purposes, is that powdery mildews and many other organisms just really don't like UV at night. And that means we can kill them with a fraction of the dose that would be required during daylight. Next, please. And so by 2019, we were able to use a tractor-drawn array of UV lamps to suppress powdery mildew on Chardonnay wine grapes to a level equivalent to that was provided by the best available fungicides. And this time we did it without defoliating the vines or creating vineyard potatoes. Next, please. Now, along the way, other members of the research team have made parallel discoveries regarding the nighttime UV treatments directed at powdery mildew. They also suppressed a number of other destructive diseases. For example, sour rot is a bacterial decay for which we presently have no effective protective treatments. Downy mildew suppression by UV is not as pronounced as what we see in powdery mildew, but it is substantial, and we'll continue the research in that area until it improves. And perhaps most surprisingly for us, is that UV has been very effective in suppressing mite populations. Next, please. The latest development in the work has been to partner with a company called Saga Robotics to match our UV lamp array to an autonomous robotic platform. Because this is really an ideal pairing of these technologies. The lamp array is relatively lightweight. It doesn't require a great deal of power. It doesn't need a tractor to move it. And unlike a human operator, robots really don't mind working all night, every night, to cover large acreages. So the first commercial demonstration of this technology was carried out at Anthony Road Wine Company nearby. It's owned by Ann and John Martini, both of whom are well known within the US wine industry. The robot is called Torvald, and it's an interesting concept which takes our array design and it can adapt it to a broad variety of plant canopies. The array can be broadened, it can be made longer, taller, narrower to fit everything from grapevines to raised bed strawberries, to tabletop berries, to trellis tomatoes, raspberries, cucurbits, greenhouse roses, tree fruit, or anything in between. Next slide, please. So what comes next? The plan for this spring is to expand the research and demonstration trials to include four leading winery and vineyard operations across the region. to refine and demonstrate its efficacy and reliability for the New York industry, with an eye towards commercial release of the technology the following year in 2022. And with that, I see I'm coming up on my allotted time, so I'm going to thank you for having me as a guest. Thank you for your attention, and I'll be happy to hang around for as long as anyone has questions about its work, this work, or the implications for IPM programs in New York or elsewhere. Thank you.
David, thank you so much. I'm really excited about that work and that emerging research. Or I shouldn't say emerging research. The work, the research that was emerging is now well on its way to commercialization. So with that, I'm going to remind our audience members to please put any questions that you may have in the chat box or the Q&A. I did see a few pop up, so I'm going to go over to that and we'll see what we have. We have one attendee who said she always wanted to operate a live weather station. Any ideas on how to get started? Dan, I think that one is for you.
Yeah, so I put a URL link in there, but if you go to newa.cornell.edu and then you go to weather stations, you're going to find a page that gives you all the information you need to get started if you're interested in linking with NEWA. On top of that, I want to add that if you're a New York State resident, beyond the cost of getting your own weather station that's compatible, there's no additional fee. You know, we're part of the land grant mission, and we want to support agriculture across the board. So there is no cost beyond that private weather station purchase.
Great, thank you, Dan. And if I'm correct, I think IPM has started a partnership now with New York State Mesonet, which also increases the NEWA reach. Is that correct?
Yeah, we're in the final stages of working that out. But our goal is, if you remember that map, there's big areas where there's gaps in coverage, basically. And those maybe might be areas of slightly higher need, actually, especially with field crops production and livestock and things like that. So our goal is to continue expanding this network. And that is going to be a key partnership moving forward.
Fantastic. Thank you, Dan. And David, just to warn you, you're starting to get quite a few questions come in on the UV light. So I'm going to ask you the first one from Lorraine, which is, hello, has the UV light trial been used in ornamentals for the home garden? I admit, as a home gardener myself, I also would like to find that out. Thanks for the question, Lorraine. Oh, David, you're muted. You got to unmute yourself. Sorry.
So these UV lights are not easily obtained for the homeowner. In fact, they're in very short supply right now because of COVID-19. They also represent some risk to a user in that it's a bit like welding without protective equipment. So you do need to wear some special protective gear. So it's not yet amenable to the homeowner. So yes, it's used in ornamentals in commercial production. No, there are not homeowner units yet available, but the technology is very early in its development right now.
Excellent. Thank you, David. This one is also for you, which is, how long and how often must the plants be exposed to ultraviolet light?
Yeah, and that's a good question. It's like, how long is a piece of string? It depends upon the intensity of the source and the severity of the epidemic. In grapevine powdery mildew, under the most severe conditions, we're treating twice a week, but often we can achieve substantial control with once a week applications. In other crops, it can be as infrequently as once every 2 weeks.
Great, thank you, David. Yet again, a very popular part of the presentation. One more question for you, this one from the chat box, which is, David, I have a question about the UV technology. Have you done any studies on the impacts on non-target organisms, which of course is a really good question. The second part of her question is, this seems like a very broad spectrum biocide, and our concern would be that it might be impacting organisms besides powdery mildew, such as small invertebrates.
It does. It is a broad spectrum biocide. It is applied only at doses that are relatively low compared to the dose required to kill more complex organisms other than microbes. So the primary effect is on the target pathogens. As occurs with the use of a chemical fungicide, there are non-target effects, but there's no residue from a UV application, and the research we've done indicates the populations on the plant surface rebound rather quickly.
Excellent. David, yet again for you, let me also remind our audience that there's other presenters too to ask questions for if you would like, which is, are the UV light designs available for commercial growers to build? There's quite a few grape growers asking if they can build their own.
Yes, they are. In fact, there's a website for the project called lightandplanthealth.org. We have plans online, and you can get technical assistance in building your own unit from the Lighting Research Center at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, which is our partner in the project. They are the photobiologists and engineers that are the specialists in actually building the units.
Excellent. And thank you. I see Juliet, our fruit IPM specialist, put the Light and Plant Health website right into the chat box.
I'm hoping I typed it correctly, David. Correct
it's
me
the only
if
one
I'm
of
wrong.
Its kind. So okay, if you type good. Light and Plant Health into the Google window, you'll find it.
It'll be good. Okay. Perfect. I have a question since I'm unmuted for David on, you know, the UV stuff. Does the susceptibility of the vine, the variety of grape, to powdery mildew have an impact on how frequently you have to dose it with UV or the level of the dosage?
Yes. So we've done all of our testing on large scale plots on Vitis vinifera wine grapes, so the European wine grape. No doubt the North American varieties, Concord and some of the hybrids, would require less frequent dosing and a less intense exposure just because of their higher natural resistance to powdery mildew.
Great. And one more question, David, does it work for downy mildew in addition to powdery mildew? And for our audience that's not a grower member, I'll remind you that those are two separate pathogens.
Two very different pathogens with very different environmental conditions. And the degree of control provided by UV against downy mildew is not anywhere near as effective as it is for powdery mildew. So you can't rely upon UV alone to control downy mildew, at least not reliably and not yet. But it's a beneficial side effect at this point, giving about 50% suppression of downy mildew.
Great. Now, Alejandro, I had a question in the chat box for you, which is, can you explain what a biopesticide actually is and what the difference is between a biopesticide and a conventional pesticide?
That's a good question. So they're synthetic insecticides that are pretty much, they're not derived from any plant material or any other live organism. And biopesticides are typically the most common ones are from a fermentation, a process of fermentation, a fungus, plant base, and the structure, they don't, the chemical companies, they don't play too much with the structure. Those synthetic insecticides, that's where they start playing with that structure, and they have some changes, and that's what it's called a synthetic pesticide. But usually they're derived from some sort of live material. Typically is from a fungus or some sort of another type of fermentation. And about pesticides also, they can even consider even biocontrol agents, some live organisms as well. They're considered biopesticides like Bt, Bacillus thuringiensis, which is a commonly used pesticide use on worms. So I don't know if that answers the question.
Yep, perfectly, Alejandro, thank you. I'm gonna take two more questions and then we'll conclude and appreciate everybody's time. So Juliet Carroll, we have one question for you. You mentioned creating more effective traps for spotted wing Drosophila. Can you describe what you're using now and how the trap may change to be more effective?
Yeah, so right now the trap that's used is what's called a drowning trap. I'm just gonna hold up my water bottle. So think about a peanut butter jar that's full of water with a little bit of drop of an unscented soap to break the surface tension. And then you've got a lure inside that. The insects go in there and they drown. So within a week's time, you've got all these dead insect bodies. You filter them out, you take them back to the lab and you look at them through the microscope and you sift through them. It's time consuming and not a lot of fun. The traps that we are going to be looking at are traps that growers are much more familiar with. These are yellow sticky cards or red sticky cards. They would be, so this is a manila envelope. They'd be about half the size of this manila envelope, and they'd be sticky on both sides. You'd hang it with the lure in the fruit planting, and then you can just go in and count just the male flies. The females have a serrated ovipositor, their structure that helps them lay eggs into the fruit. It cuts right into the beautiful ripe fruit. And they you really have to identify the females under the microscope. So basically, if you're just looking for the spotted wing Drosophila, the male has those spots on each wing, very easy to identify, and the grower can go and very readily count the flies on that trap. In Ontario, Canada, and New Jersey, they have started using the sticky card traps with the lure. And in New Jersey, they're using it in commercial blueberry production. And as many of you may know, New Jersey is a wholesale commercial blueberry producer. So if their blueberry growers can do it, I know that our blueberry growers and our cherry growers can do this, as our raspberry growers, et cetera. So that's what we're going to be looking at, hopefully, if we get funded on this grant. So I'm pretty excited about it.
Juliet, thank you. And our last question is for Jody. Again, continuing in the ick factor on rats, a very good question. Are there options to manage the parasites, mites, ticks, fleas on the rodents themselves?
I would say no. I would also caveat that with there are probably options for pet rodents, and there are fancy rats and all that, so they would also get fleas if they could. But for wild rodents, the management strategy is to eliminate the rodents, not the parasites on them. So I don't know of any technology for that.
Thank you. Well, again, just to conclude, I want to thank our audience for attending today. Really appreciate all of our speakers and our panelists. A special thank you and a shout out to Commissioner Ball, as always. And really appreciate how many people tuned in today to learn a little bit more about integrated pest management in New York State and our agricultural and community programs. So thank you.
Thank you, Julie, for hosting.
Bye. Thank you, Julie. Thank you, everyone.